Hi guys, here Rachana Phadke here, and I welcome you all to my next lecture on Yes Bank. There are many people who had told me in the live stream which I did on Teacher's Day that please give us a separate fundamental analysis video on Yes Bank. So I thought let me give you a quick overview of 4-5 points. Number one, what is the history of Yes Bank? Number two, we'll talk about the rise and fall of Yes Bank. Number three, I would like to give you my fundamental analysis on Yes Bank. Number four, we'll talk about a very basic point about support and resistance levels, about technical analysis regarding, again, Yes Bank. And the fifth one is the most important bonus tip from my side. That will be my advice to you, whether you should buy the stock right now or whether you should stay away. But as usual, I am giving this disclaimer that is based on my study. You should always do your own study and then decide that whether you should really go ahead and buy the stock or not, right? So let's move ahead with the history of Yes Bank. Yes Bank was basically founded by two people, Mr. Rana Kapoor and Mr. Ashok Kapoor, in 2004. As far as Yes Bank is concerned, right now it is in the top 10 private sector banks of India. The major revenue that Yes Bank generates is from various activities like corporate lending. Then second one, they also get a lot of fees from syndicate loans. Okay, so I'll just quickly tell you because these are the two major things that I wanted to talk about. Number one, corporate lending means they won't lend a big chunk to people like you and me. They would be lending more to companies. Okay. Second thing which I wanted to talk about, they earn one more income as fees income for arranging syndicate loans. Okay, so let's understand in simple words what's a syndicate loan. Basically, the person who arranges a syndicate loan, in our example, Yes Bank, is like a marriage bureau. Okay, there is a bride, there is a groom, and the marriage bureau basically decides, are these a perfect match or not? And marriage bureau is going to charge something in return, right? Similarly, what Yes Bank does, there's a big borrower who wants to buy a huge money. There are 3-4 banks who are willing to lend money, but then they don't know each other, right? So Yes Bank is the one who is basically doing this matchmaking, and for that syndicate, so this typical arrangement of a syndicate loan, Yes Bank will charge some fees for arranging this syndicate loan. Okay, so this is one more major income for Yes Bank. As far as the percentages are concerned, corporate banking loans versus retail banking loans, Yes Bank almost has given 65.6% of its total advances only to corporate advances. And for retail sector, that's like people like you and me, it's only 34.4%. Okay, some other business avenues for Yes Bank are investment banking, corporate finance, financial marketing, and retail banking. Yes Bank basically had listed in on BSE as well as NSE in 2005 at an issue price of only 45 rupees. Okay, still after this big bloodbath, it's still trading at a price above its issue price. But those who have tracked the share, you know what highs it had touched. But way back in 2005, it was 45 rupees. And one more important point I would like to tell you, that currently, as on 30th of June 2019, that is the latest data which I found, which was publicly available. It has 1,122 branches and 1,120 ATMs in India. So you can easily understand the widespread of Yes Bank. I hope you have understood about the history of Yes Bank. So moving ahead with the rise and fall of Yes Bank, let me just give you an interesting piece of information. It was in 1999 that Ashok Kapoor, who was the ex-head of ABN AMRO Bank, Harkit Singh, who was the ex-head of Deutsche Bank, and Rana Kapoor, who was the ex-head of corporate finance at ANZ Grinlays Bank, they came together and set up a non-banking financial company with Rabobank, which is of Netherlands, in which Indian partners held only 25% and Rabo held 75%. Kuch samajh mein aaya? Okay, it was actually like three big people, three heads of three different banks came together, and they partnered with a bank from Netherlands. Indian three partners were holding 25%, and this Netherlands bank, Rabo Bank, that's what we are saying, they held 75%. This was in 1999. Then what happened? In 2003, this same NBFC got a banking license. But at this point, Harkit Singh, who was the ex-country head of Deutsche Bank and who was one of the key promoters of Yes Bank, he quit. And now Yes Bank only had two major promoters. One was Ashok Kapoor with a K-A-P-U-R and Rana Kapoor with a K-A-P-O-O-R. Why I thought of telling this to you, because if you happen to do a research, many times only Kapoor is given. Then which Kapoor is which Kapoor? Rana Kapoor or Ashok Kapoor? For that, you should know this. Ashok Kapoor is spelled with a K-A-P-U-R. Okay. Let me just give you a brief about who Rana Kapoor was. He was a person who graduated from Shriram College of Commerce. He got his MBA degree from Rutgers University, USA. In 1980, he joined Bank of America and he was a management trainee there. He completed almost 16 years of service in the same bank. Afterwards, he joined ANZ Grindlay's Investment Bank, and wherein he became the GM and the country head. This was a brief about Rana Kapoor. Ashok Kapoor, on the other hand, he started his career with Grindlay's Bank and he moved to ABN AMRO's. And he was the first Asian who became ABN AMRO's country manager for India. These two were doing a fantastic job. Year on year, the loan book was increasing. They were giving fantastic loans. Corporate loans were on a rise. Interest margins were on a rise. Profits were on a rise. This bank was doing phenomenally well. And I couldn't see any reason why any investor about in the stock market would want to stay away from this bank. Because you check out quarter on quarter results, you check year on year results, they were doing phenomenally well. In fact, the share price, which got an issue price of 45 rupees, it had crossed 400 rupees on the Indian stock exchanges. So then, if everything was going right, what happened? What led to the fall of a Yes Bank? That's what we want to see. In 2008, the story of Yes Bank took a U-turn. Ashok Kapoor and his wife, Madhu Kapoor, they had visited the Trident Hotel. It was in the terrorist attack of 26/11, where unfortunately, Mr. Ashok Kapoor was killed by the terrorists. His body was found lying on the 19th floor of Trident Hotel. It was very surprising that after this attack in 2008, of course, the family was in big grief. But almost 3-4 years later, that is in 2012, Rana Kapoor published a brief history about Yes Bank. It was very surprising and shocking that not even a slightest mention was made about one of the co-founders of Yes Bank, who was Mr. Ashok Kapoor. There were many questions raised as to why his name even didn't find a mention in this entire story. In the meantime, what Mr. Rana Kapoor did was that he also appointed few more directors on the board of Yes Bank. To name these, they were Divan Arun Nanda, Ravish Chopra and M.R. Srinivasan. All these names are currently in the midst of a storm which the Yes Bank is facing right now. The director's appointment was not even put forth in front of the wife of Ashok Kapoor, neither any other family member of Ashok Kapoor. His wife, Ms. Madhu Kapoor, then came ahead and filed a complaint with the Indian court system, and she said that she should be appointed as one of the board of directors, or at least her daughter, she should be, her daughter who was Shagun, she should be appointed to the board of directors. Of course, it's our Indian system, court system. The decisions won't come within 2 nights. It took almost 3 years. And in 2015, a judgment came in whereby Madhu Kapoor and Shagun Kapoor were put on the board of directors. This was a big relief for them. And also a big blow for Rana Kapoor came up because the appointment of all these directors, I'll just name all these directors along with the three directors whom I talked about. It said the High Court order said that the directors of Yes Bank, Mr. Ravish Chopra, M.R. Srinivasan, Divan Arun Nanda, Ajay Vora, Rajat Monga, Sanjay Palve and Pralay Mondal, all these appointments of all these people were treated to be ultra virus. Ultra virus is basically beyond the powers of any person, and they were treated as null and void. Null and void means basically they were treated to be illegal. There was one more big blow in the year 2015 when RBI took up asset quality reviews, which is very commonly referred to as AQR, of various banks. Let me tell you quickly what is an AQR. Generally, banks' major business is to give loans and earn interest income out of that. But whenever any borrower fails to repay this loan, this category of loan is known as a bad loan, or very commonly known as an NPA, which is a non-performing asset. Now, it is the bank's responsibility to report that how many loans have become NPAs, how many loans in short have become bad. One more simple word for that, this loan is now irrecoverable, right? So it's the bank's responsibility to publish these numbers of NPAs. What RBI does is that RBI performs one more audit of asset quality review, and they check whether the reported numbers of NPAs match with their audit of the NPAs, match with their figures of NPAs. Now, if there is a difference between these figures, this technically is known as a divergence. I'll give you a simple example. Let's say Yes Bank had declared 200 crores of NPAs, but
in the RBI asset quality review audit, let's say their figure comes up to 350 crore rupees of NPAs. So in simple words, 350 crore rupees of NPAs as per RBI versus 200 crores, which was reported by Yes Bank, then the divergence will be treated as 150 crores. I hope you understood the concept of asset loan divergence. Now, there are some important figures which I came across in my study. In March 2016, the total divergence which was seen was of 4,176 crores, which was a huge number. In the next year, even a larger divergence of 6,355 crores came into light. Well, these two figures actually shook the entire shareholders community, and people started doubting about the honesty of the bank. One more important event happened in 2016 when Yes Bank came up with a qualified institutional placement offer. And what happened was, the day it was actually offered for qualified institutional placement, within few hours, it was withdrawn. This led to a big beating on the stock, and the share price crashed in a matter of few minutes. What happened in 2018, June, was a bit more surprising, whereby the shareholders of Yes Bank, in spite of all these events in picture, they approved the appointment of Rana Kapoor as the CEO for another term of 3 years. But please understand, even if shareholders make any such appointments, they have to be approved by RBI. Here, RBI took a stand and they said that we are ready to give an extension, but only till 31st January 2019. This was a big blow for the Yes Bank promoter, Rana Kapoor. And that's where I may say that one of the final blows came into picture for Yes Bank. Moving on to my favorite part, which is fundamental analysis. Of course, I'm not going to dig down deep, but I feel I will tell you all the key important points, at least five major points, which you should see when doing a fundamental analysis of any bank. The very first point, which you can see here right on the screen, is the net NPAs as a percentage to the total advances. And here you can see gross NPAs as a percentage to total advances. I'll tell you the interpretation of this as well. See, here you can see the ratio of gross NPA to total advances is 3.22%. Means what? If they have given an advance of 100 rupees, in simple words, 100 rupees ka loan diya hai. Out of this 100 rupees, 3 rupees are not repaid. Okay, that's a worrisome figure. In the previous year, 17-18, it was only 1.28, and this year it has increased to 3.22. It has almost tripled. It's a very, very dangerous number. Even the net NPAs to advances, it was 0.64% and it has more than doubled. So please understand the impact of NPAs. I have told you what is an NPA. It's like a bad loan. It's an irrecoverable loan. The moment your NPAs as a percentage of advances goes on increasing, you have to check this figure for any bank if this is increasing. And if it is increasing like two or three times, it's a very, very bad situation for the bank. Number one. Number two, if I go on to their operating performance, two or three points are not that bad. Like their interest income has grown by almost 46%. Their overall net interest income, I'll tell you quickly what is a net interest income. It means that interest earned minus interest expended is the net interest income. Just to give you a simple example, if they are earning 10 rupees on loan and if they are paying 5 rupees as an interest on fixed deposit, then their net interest income is 10 minus 5, which is equal to 5. So the net interest income has increased by 26%, which is also not that bad. But the biggest point comes up is about provisions and contingencies. What is this provision? See, mainly whenever any bank reports a non-performing asset, as per the RBI rules, they have to make some provision against NPAs. In simple words, what is a provision? Provision means you keep some money aside to meet out some future liability. So more and more NPAs you have, more and more provisions you have to make. What has happened to their provisions? Their provisions have increased a maddening of 271.8%. The provision was 15,538 millions and now it has gone up to 57,775 millions. That's a huge number, 271% increase in provisions. Not at all a good sign. So this was the third parameter, important parameter. Gross NPA to advances, net NPA to advances. Third one was your provisions and contingencies. Fourth point, obviously you have to have a look at their final profitability. Net profit, if you can see here, net profit has gone down 59.3%. That's a huge number. One last point, fifth parameter, which I wanted to talk about, is the shareholding pattern. And here we talk about pledged shares. Pledged shares basically means that how many shares the promoter holds and how much shares out of these they have pledged with the bank. In Hindi, we call it as girvi rakhna. Okay. So out of the total shares which the promoters have, you can see here 42% of the total shares have been pledged with the bank. Okay. Having 1 or 2% as pledged shares, that's still fair enough. 42% is not at all acceptable. So if you ask me about fundamental analysis of this company, I don't think I should comment on this. I hope I've given you all 5 key parameters of any bank, which is you have to check the gross NPAs to advances, net NPA to advances. You can check the interest margins. You can check how much was their profitability. You can check how much are their shares, which are encumbered, which are pledged with the bank. All are giving a 0 out of whatever. So I don't think this is a good one as far as the fundamental analysis is concerned. Moving on to the last part, which is technical analysis. I'm not going to go deep down into technical analysis. I'm not going to talk about MACD, RSI, Bollinger Bands and all that. I'm just going to talk about something known as a support level. Okay. What is technical analysis? In short, it means that history repeats itself is the basic premise on which technical analysis is based. It means that in the past, if a specific share price was found as a support level in the past, maybe 2 years ago, 3 years ago, the same price will get honored even today. Right now, if you can see here on my screen, the price has closed today. Today is 6th of September, that is Friday. The video will be released tomorrow. But today, the price at which the Yes Bank has shown as a closing is at 60.75. Now, the question is how far it can go down. For that, we need to check what's the support level for that. Can we see a support right on the screen? Answer is no. So I'm just zooming out. I'm just taking you back to a few years. Now you can see here, I'm roughly in the range of 2010 to 2015, where this level was seen so many years ago. I've just drawn a horizontal line. Here you can see the price of Yes Bank has seen a support at this level 1. Again, it has touched here 2, almost here 3, 4, 5 times. After which it had run up in the sky. So that's what I'm talking about. If it has seen a support at this level in the past, ideally it should see a support even today. What is this level though? This is 45 to 47 range. It's way too below the current trading price, which is at almost 60 rupees. So again, I'm repeating, this is not a direct suggestion for you all, but this is my studies, this is my analysis. Ideally, the share price should still see a correction. It should still be in a downward trend from 60 rupees to nearly about 45 to 47 rupees. So as a conclusion, I would like to tell you that as far as my studies are concerned, you should not invest in Yes Bank right away. Wait and watch. Check out for these levels. If these levels are also broken, it would become a big mess. But as of now, I feel don't catch this falling knife and stay away from this. That was about my analysis on Yes Bank. I hope you have liked this analysis. Do let me know in the comment section if you want me to make videos on any other company or not. That's it from my side. Jai Hind. Bye-bye.